Penguin Audio presents Mama Made the Difference, Life Lessons My Mother Taught Me by T.D. Jakes. Read by Richard Allen. Introduction. Timeless Teachers in the Classroom of Life. I'll never forget the feeling of entering that room for the first time. After walking down the hill from my house with my mother, I strolled nervously down the long, never-ending hallway amidst the chattering bustle of others my size and many more who were much larger than my boyhood frame. Nervousness, excitement, a little fear, and a large dose of curiosity infused my system with a powerful elixir. Inside the room that would become a kind of second home to me for the next 9 months, I scanned the brightly colored bulletin boards, the blackboard that dominated an entire wall, the green border above it with its neatly scrolled alphabet letters that I would soon be expected to master, the many rows of desks and chairs that were just my size. The place smelled of chalk dust and ammonia, laced with the scent of daisies from the bouquet on the teacher's desk, and perhaps just a hint of her sweet perfume. As I peered in, other curious faces looked back at me, each of them just as eager and terrified as I was on this first day of school. Mrs. Dills looked up at me and smiled, and I felt that school might not be so bad after all. At that moment, I let go of my mother's hand. She, who had guided me through the labyrinthine halls of this new, strange, and exhilarating locale, and stepped forward with the same sense of monumental achievement as the first man on the moon. Who can forget their introduction into the education system? We all had to take that first big step toward maturity and intellectual stimulation, a step that would shape and craft us into a smarter version of ourselves. Perhaps it was easier for me because my mother was a teacher, both by profession but also by her very nature. She couldn't pass up any opportunity, and they were abundant each day, to share with others her contagious curiosity about everything around her. She handed out lessons to those of us around her the way a millionaire hands out tips. Because of the life lessons that Mama had already started teaching me, I quickly felt at home in my new classroom. I discovered that I was used to paying attention to each day's lessons because my mother had already instilled in me an appreciation of information, knowledge, and most precious of all, wisdom. In fact, my mother had already shared her view that life itself is the classroom that God gives us to learn who we are, who He is, and how we are to become who He created us to be. I learned some of life's most important lessons long before I entered first grade. This proclivity toward lifelong learning continues to be one of the most significant legacies my mother left me. Thinking about my mother and the many other mothers I know, along with numerous observations and experiences gleaned from other people about their mothers, I think it's time to pay tribute to these most influential of educators, our mamas. I believe the time is right to examine the legacy that our mothers continue to bequeath to us, and to heed their lessons as we move forward into our own God-given destinies. It's not just that our mother's wisdom is timeless, but that is especially timely today in our 21st century. You see, I've witnessed a growing apathy toward motherhood. With all of our many advances in technology and corporate culture, women are now expected to excel in the boardroom as well as the kitchen. The woman who doesn't wish to work outside her home is often looked down upon as being old-fashioned or incapable of the immense juggling act that her sisters enact around her. But we need mothers, along with their luminous lessons that shine across the shadows of time more than ever. Women should not have to apologize for being mothers. As a society, we're in trouble when we don't value our children enough to place them above our careers, our leisure activities, or our goals of self-improvement. No, we must step back and realize that mothers have often shaped our world from the cradle. By rocking, nurturing, and instructing children who grow up to make life-changing and history-making accomplishments. Every radical revolutionary or fast-forward fashionista, every preacher and president, every molecular scientist and internet technician, There's a mother behind them who fostered her children's sensibilities to their potential. Have you ever considered the way your mother has shaped the person you are today? Learning from our mothers, whether they are biological, emotional, or spiritual mothers to us, is something that all of us share. You see, everybody has a mother. The hardened criminal on death row and the successful executive on Wall Street, heads of state and heads of major corporations all entered this world through the painful labor of a woman. And if that woman didn't raise and nurture them, then there was likely another woman, an aunt, a big sister, a church mother, who loved them as her own. Indeed, if there is one thing each member of the human race has in common with all others, it is that each one of us is someone's child. We all began our life's journey in a woman's womb. All of us who live and have ever lived came into being through a woman to whom God said, "I need you to assist me in the miracle of life." He trusts mothers so much that he allows them to share in his creative work. Mothers are the banks into which God has chosen to deposit life. It's been that way since the very first birth on earth, and it is still that way all over the planet. The vital role that mothers play has not diminished over time, but our perception of mothers has shifted dramatically. Consider for a moment the way we have watched the image of motherhood evolve on the screens of our television sets. We have seen the glories and the challenges of motherhood portrayed in Carolyn Ingalls, Olivia Walton, Aunt Bee, June Cleaver, and Carol Brady, to name a few. But the days of Leave It to Beaver and the Brady Bunch are no more. Rarely will you find a woman who cleans house and bakes pies and cookies every single day. You are less likely to stumble upon a lady who starches both her aprons and the bed sheets of her entire household. In fact, if you were to knock on the doors of 100 households, you would find only 30 women who could be called stay-at-home moms. No. Mothers today work inside the home, outside the home, and everywhere in between as they shuttle between their kids' school and their office, not to mention the grocery store and dry cleaner. According to an ABC News original report on May 8, 2005, 70% of mothers who have children under the age of 18 balance outside employment with their duties at home. The same report cites that 61.8% of mothers with children under the age of 6 have jobs outside the home. The television mothers many of us grew up with did not work. Oh, there was at least one Andy Griffith episode in which Aunt Bee secured a job, but by the time the ending credits rolled, she was happily back in her kitchen to stay. In 1984, our perception of mothers, at least the characters we saw on our television screens, began to change with the introduction of a trailblazing working mother in the character of Claire Huxtable on The Cosby Show. Claire was the mother of 5 children, whose ages ranged from elementary school to post-college. She was a devoted mother, able to provide insight and wisdom to her children when needed and to keep a perfect house, all while maintaining her position as a busy attorney. Sure, we can admire Claire Huxtable for being able to perform a difficult job while raising a healthy, thriving family, but she is not a realistic example of a working mother. Most working mothers struggle with feelings of guilt because they are unable to be with their children as much as stay-at-home moms can. In addition, they sometimes face criticism, wage discrimination, and severe time constraints. And many working mothers have what works out to be at least 2 full-time jobs, bringing home the bacon and having to fry it up in a pan. However, working moms are not the only ones who struggle today. Young mothers, those who become pregnant as teenagers and even preteens, are also a great concern. In the year 2000, 83 of every 1,000 teenage girls in America got pregnant. In 2002, girls between the ages of 10 and 14 gave birth to 7,315 babies. The number of teenage pregnancies in America is declining, but it is still alarming. Our children are having children. And if it is difficult to raise children, think how much harder it is when you are just a child yourself. Some young women who found themselves pregnant have had abortions. Some have given their babies up for adoption. Some have tried to hide. Some have failed miserably as they struggled to raise a child for whom they were unprepared. On the other hand, Some say they have been successful, usually because...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.